Hello, everyone, and welcome back to the DreamHack Open 2015 live from tour. I'm Richard Lewis. With me is Wax Angel, and we've got two casters as well because they're probably going to do some casting in a little bit. We've got Todd and Nathanius. I know, yeah, you've had it easy today, wandering around accepting gifts from strangers. It's just like your stream, isn't it?
Yeah,
it's great. Anyway. This is the other semi-final. This is going to be a great matchup. We've already had some incredible games, although ultimately we've arrived with one finalist we expected, parting already in the final, as you'll be able to see on the bracket now. There he is. Boom.
Are any of us actually surprised, though?
Well, I mean, I don't know, Wax, actually. You did make the point that, you felt there was a few little wobbles.
I felt like, Parting was always going to be one of the favorites to make the finals, but along the way, he's made some weird mistakes, like in his game versus Mana. The first game, he had that thing where he was supply blocked and it went poorly, even though he won in the end. And then again, like just now against Hyun, game one, he was in such a good position. And then, he even said in his interview, what the hell was I doing? I was embarrassed in that game. So he's making these weird mistakes, even though he's like the superior player in a lot of these matchups.
I don't know what to make of that, because if you're making mistakes, but you still kind of crushing your opponents.
I can't tell you what to make of it. Nobody plays perfect in StarCraft 2. Everybody's going to make mistakes here and there. Winning is what's important. And so far, he's done a fantastic job of it because he hasn't lost any series.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yes, nothing.
No one makes mistakes. Have you seen the people in the chat watching, man? They got the best advice you possibly get for this game.
It's true.
Hey, don't diss the Twitch chat, man. You rely a lot on these guys on your stream.
I was going to say, don't turn on Twitch, mate, or you'll be homeless. let's talk about other things that are true. True versus Gumiho. We're kind of split on the panel on this. Obviously, Apollo's just off to one side at the moment. He's like got his little true sign out. He's ready to back his boy. What do you guys think? I mean, is Gumiho the superior player? Is he the guy we should be backing?
I thought it was very interesting that Harston pointed out True spending a lot of time actually playing in Europe because the European players are actually pretty... Those Europeans who do mech builds do them very well. Tintaren versus Zerg. I don't think the results lately have been showing that Terran is crushing across the board. There's been a lot of Zergs that have been really manhandling Terrans, and not all Terrans have switched over to mech. But Gumiho is one of the players who does mech better than most, in my opinion. And I think that's something that is going to have a really interesting role because, what has True actually been practicing against as far as his Terran opponents go before this match?
Well, Wax might know. Any ideas?
I feel like it could be similar to the series you just played against Patience. It could just be a lot of weird stuff and cheese because that's kind of what got him noticed in the first place. Maybe not so much in ZBT as much as in ZBT. Yeah. But if you look at their head-to-head, he's quite behind. He's a decent amount behind Gumiho in head-to-head. And if he's not confident in straight-up games, he might resort to those unrandom tactics.
Any thoughts to add, Todd?
Do you know if Gumiho mechs every game against her?
Not every game, no. Okay. He has some very good mech builds, though. He's like one of the guys, if you want to do it, you follow his builds because he doesn't always do the standard ones. He's not easy to kill with Fast Muter or Roach.
Okay. Well, we're going to go over to the stage now. We've got Smix, who's been doing the interviews all day. And here we go. This is the last one before we get to the final. So take it away, Smix.
That's right, Richard. This is it. This is the last semifinal before we find out who will join Parting in the grand finals door. Help me welcome these next two players, Gumiho and True. True. I actually just spoke to you, and you stated that you felt that Gumiho was a very difficult opponent and you don't like to face him. That being said, I'm sure that your desire to get to the finals for the first time in a premier tournament has to be greater than that.
Yes, he is hard for me, but I will do my best for you guys.
Gumiho, just like True, you have never reached the grand finals of a premier tournament, and you have a great chance right here, right now, going up against True, because you are ahead in head-to-head score by a long shot. I mean, you must feel pretty confident headed into this match. 일단 그 방태수 선수와 이제 만나게 됐는데 결승전에 간 적이 없잖아요. 근데 어떻게 보면 이게 되게 좋은 기회예요. 왜냐하면 방태수 선수와 만났을 때 구미호 선수가 훨씬 더 많이 이겼어요. 그러니까 이 뭐지 4강 들어왔을 때 좀 자신감이 넘칠 것 같아요.
4강 대진 봤을 때 자신감이 넘쳤고요. 좋은 기회만큼 절대 놓치지 않도록 하고 이번에 놓치면 언제 올지 모르기 때문에 반드시 이기도록 하겠습니다.
Says as soon as I saw who I was going to be playing in the semifinals, I was very, very happy and very confident. And just as great of an opportunity as this is, I'll make sure to win and grab this opportunity because I don't know when it will come again. So please cheer for me. I can't wait to find out who will join Parting in the grand finals. Players shake hands. It's time to get ready for this game. Before we get this game underway, let's head to the experts and see what their thoughts are on who's going to make it to the grand finals.
I think she gets a little bit of a break now, which she absolutely deserves. She had a much longer rehearsal than we did. Now, we've got a split desk. We've got a divided desk here, I think, because there's been lots of people pledging allegiance to Drew. We've got self-declared gummy bros. I'm looking at you, Nathanius. So I guess it's only fair we start talking about how you think this matchup could go. Whoever wants to weigh in first, you're more than welcome.
Go ahead, Nate.
It all comes down in a big way, in big sort of ways. The maps are very important. if Gumiho wants to play mech, he's going to be looking at Echo, Coda, and Bonnie Research Station. Terrans don't want to play as much on Expedition Lost against Zerg. Expedition Lost is slowly becoming not quite as bad, but still, like, the Terrans don't want to play it. Cactus Valley is a big no-no. Mm. So with one veto,
what does he veto?
I think the Terran play, you got to take out... I think Expedition Lost, because you have the back rocks open. Like, taking the third base gets really weird. And also because True is very aggressive, and the proxy hatch and whatnot is something that not only works against Protoss, but it's kind of tricky to deal with if you're Terran, because Gumiho is not really like the aggressive all-in kind of guy. We saw even versus Marine King, who basically two-base all-in him every game. He still got the third command center every game, too. He wasn't willing to play on his level for the most part, and I think he's still going to try to keep that style. I don't expect all-in type play from Gumiho in this series.
Two racks likely?
No, not Gumiho. No.
So you, by all-in, you mean like... basically, no two racks, no.
I think Gumiho's gonna play pretty straight up. Okay. Like maybe three command center builds, something bunny style, where because a lot of Terran players will still do Hellbat pushes with third CCs, and that's within Gumiho's repertoire, and even opening up just straight Marines to defend against things like early Roach pushes. But he's not really, he never strikes me as the kind of guy to cheese or go crazy all in. He plays a pretty methodical game all the way throughout, just with his own quirks.
Well, on that thought, I'll bring Wax in here because you've got some thoughts about how you think this one might go.
Yeah, I mean, whether it's bio or mech, I think Gumiho has the advantage in straight up games. But, you know, True to some extent is like the Bly of Korea, and sometimes you just can't glide.
Yeah.
And
you went for it.
Yeah, and I feel like Gumiho knows that True might try to cheese him, but the fact that, like, you know, True was so, you know, wary of facing Gumiho, and, you know, the fact that their head to head is so much in Gumiho's favor, I gotta say, even with, you know, the randomness put in, I gotta say Gumiho's got the advantage here.
Okay, so let's start pinning down accurate predictions. Todd, you've been very quiet over there. I got an inkling why.
I'm Protoss, man.
Yeah, exactly. we'll start with your prediction for what it's worth. It's probably about as good as one of mine.
Which is?
Yeah, no, I'm not going to predict that.
Okay, all right. I'll go for Gumiho. This guy sold me, you know, praising him a lot. I think, you know, his style... I mean, according to Nate, he can not only play bio, he can play mech very well here as well. It's going to be very difficult for True to make something happen. And Wax talk about some very aggressive plans, some all-ins. I mean, Terrans don't really lose that against that too much anymore.
So a clean sweep for Gumiho from our experts. Apollo's face is like thunder right now. He can't believe you've said that. So without any further ado, I think we need to get into this game. It's Gumiho versus True. So we're going to have this casted by Nathanius and Todd. Take it away, boys.
Thanks, Richard. Nothing more fun than taking it away from you. Ty, we've got an awesome TVZ semifinal. The crowd seems hyped for some Terran, the last Terran in this tournament.
And so are you.
Yeah, well,
That's why we're the Gumi bros, man. We gotta look out for each other. This is gonna be a really sick match. We've received confirmation. We're already loading into the game, so we don't even need to waste too much of your time talking nonsense as we get ready to go into this. I'm just hyped, Todd.
As am I, man. I can't wait to see which one of these guys will be taking on Parting later.
I'm even going to do you a favor and say that if True tries to be cheesy, there's one thing Terran has over Protoss. It's much easier to defend those early Zerg cheeses, I think. I think that you have a lot better options as Terran, and I think True trying to get aggressive against him will be very, very tricky. But we're loaded in. We're loaded into game number one. You can see it is Expedition lost. And in the top right position, we have the red Zerg player representing team Dead Pixels. Give it up for True. His opponent in the southwest position, coming here representing Invasion Esports, the blue Terran, he is Gumiho.
I guess the crowd has a favorite here in Athenius. They've been sold as well.
My Terran bias had to kick in at some point in this tournament. Now we're ready. We have the representative.
Yeah, Terran bias, but the analysis, though, this was your predicted veto. Maybe I should take over the analysis in this series, Nate.
The thing is, this is a map where you can kind of get a... If you take, depending on the style that you want to play, like you can play bio and eliminate most of the problems with this map, assuming that the Zerg player is being aggressive. Because the biggest issue with... Expedition lost for Terran against Zerg is if the game goes long, the Zerg, much like an Overgrowth, can have the back corner as their fourth base, and it becomes very difficult to push that because as the Zerg spreads the creep and takes the watchtower, you're forced into a funnel, and then the Zerg can go for a lot of counterattacks. If True is aggressive, that's not really an issue because we're not looking at a super long game. It's more like how does Gumiho handle it, and this, for that reason alone, makes me think it's not a bad map for Gumiho to play with a bio opening or a bio build. And just based on the way that he set himself up, this is a very Gumiho-esque style. It's not going to be a Reaper. This map doesn't really favor Reaper. Something that Gumiho does a lot of, maybe, and he still technically could get a Reaper, I guess. He has the resources for it. I don't want to completely count it out. But he's the kind of guy who'll open up with Marines and then go for a quick reactor. But he likes a lot of early Marine play. Doesn't like to leave himself too exposed. Yeah. He could rush straight up to factory.
Compared to other Terrans, right?
Yeah, compared to other Terrans. He's like that kind of guy that plays around with this a bit more. One of the builds I really liked that he used to do would just be straight two Marines into a reactor. He'd get a lot of Marines early on. It was very difficult to kill him with anything like fast roaches or speedling because he'd have a full bunker, whereas most Terrans don't have that at the start of the game. True choosing to open up with a pretty quick gas. He can move into speed at a decent time. But I'm mostly interested to know if True gets aggressive, how does he do it? Because he's obviously not gone for the proxy on this map, which happens against Terran and Protoss as well. So we're kind of in the same realm of build orders right now.
So being a Terran yourself, you've talked a lot about how you think Gumiho should go into this match and play like. But as far as True here goes up against Gumiho, what's one of the good ways that he can play that will do well against a Terran like that?
I mean, really, the most important thing for True, and this is what makes Gumiho such a weapon, is knowing what he's doing.
Yeah.
If he had an Overlord scout, for example, go to his base, in the very beginning of the game, if he were to go to the main base ramp, as this Reaper starts to do a little bit poking at these Zerglings and these drones, he didn't even wall off his main going down to the natural. Like, he built his first two supply depots behind his mineral line. His Overlord wouldn't have seen anything at the ramp and could have made him feel, like there was a possibility of something crazy. And this is why most Terrans don't like to open Reaper on this map, because it's hard to get away. But you can't really escape now. There's only one way out.
Yeah. To me, Gumiho is a Terran that's, Heart of the Swarm is basically a game that was made for this guy to play. He loves to harass and macro at the same time very well in, Terran. They get Reapers, they get Medivacs, they get Bio. And this guy, it really feels like when he gets in that comfort zone, when he's on three bases, he gets to drop here and there and he doesn't get shut down.
I'm really surprised.
He's going to be able to do well.
Really surprised he escaped with that Reaper. Yeah. That's a true accomplishment. Most of the time, Terran players are willing to throw that Reaper away since they know it's difficult to get out. But Gumiho has always been an innovator in matchups. One of my favorite games that I recall of him was actually, I believe, at DreamHack Summer 2013 when he played against Jadong in the top eight, and he played a really sick game on Whirlwind. He wasn't able to win it, but he had a pretty cool way of dealing with the Swarm Hosts way before, the Swarm Host turtle styles were like a big thing. And that was one of the reasons why I became a pretty big fan of him. True going for a lair on two bases is pretty standard. It's a very straight up way of opening. It'll deal with a lot of aggressive plays if you can get up to Spire Tech.
And this is the moment that Gumiho wants to exploit. This move out, this is something that Gumiho does, though. He does this in a lot of his games.
There's no units on the way here for True. He's only drones. He's getting one Spinecrawler up the ramp, but there's quite a few units here for Gumiho. He might try to go for some drones. True supply blocked, and he never started any links before that. It's going to be two queens plus the drones.
Yeah, Gumiho loves to make these plays. That Spinecrawler not being done. He knows that he's going up to a fast hive. That's what the Reaper told him. And now he comes up. He's already roasted a few drones. Five down now. He might even pick off this queen. It's very, very low on health. The Hellion is still kind of chasing it around and could actually finish it off on its own and expose the rest of the drones. Another Hellion runs in. Nine drones have died. They're all lined up. 12. And Gumiho already with a pretty solid start. Honestly, it feels like a little bit of a bop there. He has the medevac follow-up. He can drop the Hellions in the main. He can just maybe even just use him to bypass the Spinecrawler.
He's going to get a Bolt Viking, man, to go for some Overlord here as well. Yeah. He's not about to stop anytime soon. It feels like True needs to drone to. He can't go for links here. He needs to be droning back up, but he's going to get hit by this, and he's going to get hit hard.
Think about what this does to your build, Todd. He rushed a lair. He has nothing to show for it. There's not even a Spire on the way. The Hellions come in. He's going to focus down the weakened Queen, picks up the weakened Hellion, and guess what? What has True really seen in this game? A bunch of Hellions, some medevacs. Okay, he moved out with the only Marines that he had, and he's just pressuring him with Hellions, so he's still not actually 100% sure. I don't believe an Overlord has gone through the base to see that he does have a Tech Lab researching stim. Gumiho will follow this up with Bio. But True has nothing to show at all for what he invested his resources in.
He didn't start the Spire or anything.
No, he can't afford to because he needs to rebuild all those drones.
And Queens, too.
Yeah.
Not quite the start True had hoped for here. Is it going to be like this the rest of the game or even maybe the series here? This is not looking good at all here for True, who's made a lot of Zerglings, but...
The wall? Well, I mean, the wall is open a little bit. He's going to try to block it with the Marines and Hellions. He's got the medevac coming back, too. Now, the Spire is starting. The lair started at 6 minutes, so the Spire should be, you know, in a normal game where this doesn't happen and you start the Spire as soon as the lair is done, you're pretty much starting your Mutalisks now. You're getting ready to move into those Mutas at this point, but he has to wait so long.
What do you think?
He doesn't have a third base either.
Yeah, with the damage that he's done here, Gumiho, what do you think about the argument for keeping those Hellions alive against sacrificing them to try and get even more drones?
I think because he wants to go into bio, the whole idea is to keep forcing him to build Zerglings, whether it's by killing drones and forcing him to build defensively or just killing the Lings that are out on the map. Because he has that medevac and because the Spire is so late, it's always going to be a consistent threat for him. He can't defend with just a Spinecrawler and Queens because he'll always be outmaneuvered by those forces.
Double Ibe is going down here, by the way, for Gumiho.
Yeah. I really like, if you're ever able to do early damage versus a Zerg player and you have one of these flexible builds like Gumiho's gone for, with the Starpour, you know, he could have always just taken the rest of the gas after he got that third command center, but he realized that he's in a position where if he deals a little bit more damage, once Stim finishes, he could put together almost unstoppable attack, because while the Spire is about to finish, and we'll have about eight or so Mutas, there's no evolution chambers, he doesn't have the third base done yet, and he certainly doesn't have any spare drones to throw over to the third base. So realistically speaking, True's only chance at this game is if his Mutalisks can come in and make a couple of key pickoffs, but Stim is already done, so he can't deny him the most important upgrade in the game at this point.
He's getting turrets here as well, Gumiho, that is. That base is pretty beautiful. Oh, he's going to go for the gold.
Well,
I guess he can afford to. He's ahead enough.
Gumiho's feeling very comfortable in this game. I definitely was not expecting him to go for that.
True is broke, man. 44 drones against 52 SCVs. He's still going for double Evo somehow, droning up here quite a bit.
And he knows where all the Mutas are. He pulls them over. He's already killing them with his Marines.
Really? True, you need to pull back, man. Wait for the Banings to finally engage into this. The Viking's pretty angry, man. It's in there.
I mean, just the start of this game, you know, True seemed all ready to rumble and then kind of just tripped and fell over with that very, very first Marine Hellion push. He kills the drones trying to transfer, and he might just kill him here, Todd. There's not that many Banelings. Baneling speed isn't ready yet either.
Yeah, he's got a bunch. Gumiho's going to pull back. He's going to make sure he fights off creep, and those Banelings don't even get the big connections. This is going to be it here. Gumiho just crushes through. Oh, no, Bane, in the first game.
He does let those Banelings get some pretty big hits, and a few more are going to finish up. I think a little bit of mismanagement. Gumiho might have been looking back home to macro a little bit or something like that. Yeah. He did plant the third command center down on the gold, but he still got more than enough to eventually push through this later on. The third base is done. These two Mutalisks are having a pretty hard time killing that Hellbat.
That Viking was there for so long.
The hero Viking.
finally fell, but at this point, I mean, true, 48 drones to 54 SCVs with the goal base in the middle of the map. Look at the trail of units.
Yeah.
Just rejoining this force, this never-ending force.
Yeah, this first game has just been a stomp. He's stimming Marines halfway across the map just to get them here faster. The drones are going to be pulled off a natural. True trying to defend against this, but without Banelings, you are not going to kill stim Marines. Todd, it doesn't happen. He's going to pick off every last worker in this base. The Mutalisks giving their last death throes, and GG is called. Gumiho will take game number one.
That was impressive, man.
Dude, Gumiho
was impressive. His base was beautiful, too. Like, you know, the way he played, the micro, everything, the macro, the way he built his base.
It's almost too good, really.
Yeah, like, very clean.
I've seen Gumiho many a time, and, you know, I was kind of expecting the sort of opening from him without the Reaper, where he would usually just go for two Marines, get the reactor, and then start his factory as the reactor is finishing and, like, go for a big Marine push early on. It's something that he does a lot, because against Zerg players, and a good number of them these days will go for fast Mutalisks off two bases, they don't have either Zergling speed or a lot of Zerglings out on the map, which allows you to push out and kill Overlords with only a couple of Hellions to support you. And in this particular instance, Gumiho was just like, your spine's not done. Okay.
Yeah, it really feels like that's what he was trying to punish. Yeah, you mentioned the Marines that he makes early on, not just to be safe, but even like he moved out with like, what, four Marines? You know, he had some units rejoining this army, and the initial drones that he got, you know.
Yeah. If you just, the best way to compare it is if you look at any other Terran, it's you get the Reaper, then the reactor, your factory, and you swap them, you know?
Yeah.
Gumiho keeps that reactor on the barracks because he knows that if True does any sort of aggressive push with roaches or banelings, he will actually have the production necessary to fill two or three bunkers, still get like trickle out a couple hellions behind, but he won't die to any all-ins. Like that's it's one of the best parts about the way that Gumiho plays. Like, and most of these.
How do you adjust to this in StarCraft? Every build has a counter. So now, if True realizes exactly what happened here and thinks that Gumiho is going to do the same, what does he do better to hold on the first attack to the first attack?
Honestly, I think just a straight up regular opening with like a good number of queens probably would have done the trick. But to open up with fast Mutalisks, you cut the investment into things like early Banelings, like early Speedlings. You don't have the evolution chambers, and you actually end up cutting queens occasionally as well. But Gumiho just kind of bopped him there is really the feeling that I got. And I'm more surprised that we go from Expedition Lost to Cactus Valley for game number two. Guys, we're loaded in. In the bottom right position, the red Zerg player down 0-1 in this best of five. Give it up for Dead Pixels, True. I'm actually really surprised by the maps now. Very interesting. I'd love to know what map this guy vetoed. In the top left position, spawning as the blue Terran representing Invasion Esports, he is Gumiho.
Playing with some sort of little handkerchief. Something on his hands.
Gumiho plays with sweaty hands, you know. Sometimes it happens.
Do you have sweaty hands, Nate?
Yeah. And Gumiho's an inspiration to all of us Terrans that, you know, I would say it comes from being worried about all-ins for me, but this guy doesn't seem to be worried about that at all. It's still going through my head now. I'm really wondering what he would have vetoed, because I imagine that True probably vetoes, if there's only one veto for a best of five, probably Infernal Pools. So maybe Gumiho vetoed Iron Fortress. I don't particularly like it either versus Zerg. Really good for backstab attacks with Speedlings. But this season has made the vetoes kind of interesting because Cactus Valley, if we just look at the way that this map is laid out, right, whether or not you want to play Mech or Bio, the third base opens up a lot of issues. If we compare it to any other map where you have a reasonable choke, the amount of depots it would take, you know, just, you know, hypothetically speaking, if you want to block it off, you are investing like 1,000 minerals into building a wall.
Does the fact that it's cross map make it very favorable for Zerg? I remember hearing a lot of stuff like this, you know, where
it's sort of the same situation as like when you're playing cross spawn and any of the other big maps that were in the pool. If you're a Terran player that wants to reinforce, it takes a long time. So he's going to squeeze out some Marines. The Reaper will get in here, and if he clicks on that extractor, he'll know it's like, okay, he definitely has the gas for speed. I will say, since he went pool first, you know, it's still actually not a crazy fast speed. Like, this is not going to be hitting at all-in level timing. So Gumiho should be in more than a comfortable enough position to deal with Lynx. The real question is, when this Reaper leaves, when True feels that the Reaper will not be able to come in and get a follow-up scout, is he going to go back on gas and throw up something like a Baneling Nest or a Roach Horn? Those are the big questions, because guess what? He's still mining a little bit of gas.
A double Reaper, man. This is pretty cool to see this.
Well, this is.
I almost never see this.
Well, this is the part where I would normally, after the game is over, tweet out, hey guys, this is something that seems like a pretty cool thing to study, because I don't see this terribly often, Todd.
It feels like it's cool to study and try and reproduce, but it feels like the thing also that will go really bad when you try that.
When you exactly. Like when you mess this up, it probably blows up in your face really big. Three Reapers is never bad because the only thing that's really that hurts Gumiho in this instance is that it delays his factory, but he doesn't seem concerned about speedling all in, which is what you would mostly need the Hellions for. Otherwise, the Marines and Reapers in bunkers can deal pretty well with anything else. It's just Gumiho being Gumiho, doing weird stuff so that we can all learn.
Open your notebook and take notes,
going,
man.
Whoa! He's going to five Reapers, Todd.
Well, so far, this could still be more, but by the look of things, I mean, he should be swapping, that factory for that barracks. The thing is, he knows that True probably wants to drone pretty hard. Yeah, actually, if he gets surrounded here or loses one of those Reapers, he's going to lose at least one. Little bit sloppy. And so far, no damage done early on Gumiho. That's the first.
How much success do you think someone must have to do something like this in this big of a game? Maybe because he's ahead? He's taking the rest of his gases, by the way. So because he hasn't started anything like Stim yet or Engineering Bays, I'm imagining this will be a mech follow-up of some kind. He could just throw on two eBays now, I guess, and a Starport, but...
Definitely a good map for it.
Little bit inefficient. I think both Bio and Mech are really solid choices on this map. Mech especially. If you break down the rocks at the third base, it's so easy to just funnel everything into that front point. But no, he's going to start extra barracks. He's not going to take any...
It's probably the easiest map in regards to that, to do that, no?
Yeah, if you can get away with it. Like, for the Zerg player, their goal will always be to slow it on your third base.
Two more barracks and Steampack, though.
Yeah. He's going to... I think Gumiho just probably just feels comfortable doing it out of this because of the way that his Hellions were delayed. So he's like, well, I can't really build up a lot of Hellions. It means I can't go fast Banshees because I delayed my factory. So let's just play around with the barracks units. He's got to be feeling very comfortable in this series. And playing Bio will give him the biggest opportunity to win the game as soon as he has a decisive edge.
Where's the Spire, Nate? It's only Ling's being made right now. He has a Baling Nest as well. True is adding on one more Extractor, which is... Okay, he's going to stop mining from it now.
True's playing a lot more straight up relative to the other games. He got a normal normally timed Baling Nest. The Lair's still reasonably quick.
He made so many Ling's. Look at this. Ling's across the map. Is he going to morph in some Baling's and go for an attack here?
It's possible that what True wants
to do... Oh, it was open. Oh, my God.
Does he realize there's no depots there?
I don't think he realizes he would have gone for it. Otherwise, even those units... Like,
I mean, if you see this,
True. There is so many Ling's. If he gets in there, surrounds this army, even morphs in some Banelings right there.
Wow, this
True.
Is super sloppy by Gumiho. He still has a lot of Marines back here to fight against the Lings, but he really can't afford to be surrounded at this point. He's
not
on
only more
SCVs.
Lings are coming in, but he's even producing 10 more right now. He's going to go get a full surround on these Marines. The STVs are being pulled in the natural. They're going to start dying left and right. Already 8 of them going down. 20 more Zerglings here on the way for True. He needs to do more damage.
I really don't understand why Gumiho didn't finish his wall. Very interesting question.
I mean, he's been doing so well. Maybe he's, starting to lay back a little bit, it easy.
He is really caught off guard by that. I don't think that was... It just kind of weird for me, but...
With his economy being weakened so much now, too, it's going to be so annoying to have to make turrets against the Mutas that are going to be made soon. 12 more drones here for True, who feels very confident. Remember, he invested a lot into this here, True. He made a lot of earnings.
It slows things down a lot. Like, Gumiho will have his 1-1 ahead, but because of all of the things that you mentioned, he needs to invest resources into the add-ons.
Yeah.
He goes for the armory. But Todd, he hasn't started the missile turrets yet, which is still another big, big part of this. This is one of those maps where it's actually really nice what you can do with Mutalis. The refineries and the main base are actually exposed if you put a missile turret just in the mineral line. So he's going to build two turrets to complement that. Then his add-ons are still exposed, so another turret. And the same holds true for the mineral line and the gas on the natural. So you do actually need two missile turrets here to cover most of this. And if the Mutas dive on him, it's actually hard to get the SCVs around the refinery to repair.
What do you think about the lack of Baneling speed so far? Like, I guess he didn't have to start it just yet.
It's the investment into the Mutas and the fact that he also went for the quick +1 attack on the Mutalisks. He's hoping to just use Lings around the map and make the Mutalisks the playmakers so he doesn't have to worry about a big push. He's already slowed Gumiho down
a lot.
He's
going to start it now. 14 more Lings here underway as well for True, who's on 66 drones to 44 SCVs. But Gumiho already started 2-2, though. He's doing always very well with these upgrades.
It was really nice. Like, the Mutalisks came just late enough that he actually got away with delaying all the turrets for the armory and the 2-2. And I think it's a very important thing to note because he's still going to get in here and kind of mess with these. Actually, really nice that he manages to
finish
combat shots. And those Mutas eat so many turret shots.
My God.
That's just unnecessary, Todd.
can't afford to lose these here. True, he's gonna have to pull back here in a second.
How many Mutalists did he just lose? Like how?
I think two or three. Yeah, two.
Yeah, that's. Considering the late Baneling speed, that's really tricky because now that he's killed so many, he can actually throw units, the Marines out on the drops. Every Mutalist that he has to replace is a handful of Banelings he won't have to defend a later attack as well. And for Gumiho, he still took that big amount of damage earlier on. He's situating himself with the rest of his infrastructure moving into the second factory and also getting the vehicle plating. But this is a time in the game where a Terran player that's going Bile wants to make a push across the map to shut down the fourth base. The fourth base is close to completing. True has it in the northeast. Yeah. This is Gumiho's moment, and True very wisely realizes this, wants to go for the backstab.
Going for the counter-attack style here. I don't think there's a bunker on the third base here for Gumiho as well. Okay.
And he did break the rocks, so, you know, it's something. Yeah. But at least the rally should cover.
Is he not going back?
And he's got a good amount of mines here. The rally covers it. Oh, wow, actually, great bait on that mine. There's not a lot of SCVs, a good number of mules.
Yeah, the mules, preventing the mules from mining there. The Banelings are going to get some connections on the SCVs, but his army is trapped here, fall true.
Yeah, there's nowhere to run. There's not enough Mutalists here to actually kill the command center, and Gumiho is just going to corner the forces. He still has the drop in the bottom right side. He's going to actually kill the hatchery. No cancel on the fourth base for True. Kills absolutely everything, and these Mutalists don't have any window to accomplish anything else.
And only six SCVs died on the third base here. As nice as it was to prevent those mules from mining, Gumiho is caught back up very nicely in terms of supply. 48 SCVs to 70 drones, but in army, man, 79 to 74 with a much earlier 2-2 for him.
This is a pretty interesting game. All things said and done, I'm really interested to see what would have happened if Gumiho hadn't thrown away a dozen or so SCVs by not building a wall at the start of it. It's very well controlled, and you know, True deciding to make that backstab attack on the third base despite the rocks being knocked down, it really hurt him. And it kind of goes to show one of the advantages on this map. If you can secure the three bases as Terran, Widow Mines or tanks, whether you're playing bio or mech, will do a great job of covering anything that tries to run between those and really do a good job of zoning out the Zerg.
Leading those Marines here a little bit, making sure one Marine is traded for one Baneling every single time. Gumiho has been impressive with the micro.
You fancy, huh, Gumiho?
I know you like those moves, Nate.
Yeah.
They get you all fired up.
Oh, boy.
You think you can do them?
There's a reason I love to watch Gumiho, and it's not because I copy his plays. It's because I wish I could.
With the double factory here, he's getting Widow Mines and the Thor simultaneously. Drilling Claws here started as well. That's going to help a lot. And with the 3-3 on the way, does he keep on trying to move across the map and be aggressive? Usually Terrans always do that. Yeah, I never understood why they don't wait maybe for it to complete.
He's just playing straight up bio, man. Yeah. Like the big focus here is going to be denying creep spread.
That's a big flock of Mutas, by the way.
Yeah, he's diving on this missile turret. He actually doesn't have full surface area available because it was built flush against the mineral line, but a couple of Marines are going to come in to reinforce, and Gumiho holds. Here come the Banelings on the fifth base. He's spreading his Marines out. Still, most of them are remaining, and he also has quite a few mine shots left,
too. He's going to go for a counterattack with another chunk of his army here. True, who needs some to defend back at home at the same time. Widow Mines are going to burrow.
The Banelings get all of them with the Widow Mines. Gumiho with a phenomenal defense. The Zerglings are going to run into his mineral line, but his rally should be able to clean it up. He sweeps up the south side base. One more hatchery did finish in the northeast. True gets on four bases some way, somehow. Denies mining on that third of Gumiho.
He's getting up for a drop down there. How many medivacs is that? I think just two. Okay, just one, four now. But I wouldn't be surprised if he regrouped on the right-hand side, fully knowing that right now the 6 o'clock base was denied here from Gumiho. All he has to do is apply pressure on the fourth, do some damage, and he's going to be in a great position. Look at this. He's regrouping. He's going to use that one medivac, the infamous medivac that brings the Zerg army out of position, ideally, so that you can push across the map comfortably here as a Terran player.
Yeah, True is close to maxing, but he has to invest so many resources into defending this, and here comes the next big push.
That is Gumiho. A lot of Banelings.
If Gumiho knocks this base down, True is in a world of hurt. All Gumiho needs to do is take this base out. He doesn't have a fourth. Very important to note. With no fourth command center, if Gumiho loses his whole army here, True does take a game-winning position with the fourth base economy and any leftover Banelings that he may have. But Gumiho's done a really good job of rallying all of his reinforcements to the natural ramp. He's basically saying, you can't do a big run-by. You can into my third base, I'll kill everything that you send, but you won't be able to slip by into my production. No lifelings in this game.
He kind of likes Widow Mines, and I think he's going to try to make up for that by just pre-splitting and hoping that True's going to engage into him. If the army of Gumiho's clumped up, he's going to get crushed here, and he's going to find himself behind, so he needs to be careful, take the fight, you know, very slowly. That turret here is going to go down. That was the only one that was there, so contaminate, actually, on the command center here. Really nice to use a little bit of that energy.
Yeah,
at the same time, though, does Gumiho finally trigger the attack across the map?
I mean, ideally,
he's pacing to go onto the fourth, and True's not ready.
Yeah, he still needs to be very careful.
Oh my.
Most of the time, the Zergs want to bait this, but the
he's
whole
so
army,
far.
He must have selected his whole army hotkey to go for the medevac in the bottom, and he loses the top right base because of it. His army completely out of position.
I think that hatchery died in like 0.1 second.
You can really see how stressed True is in this game.
3-3 completed now.
Flying all over the place trying to deal with Gumiho's multi-pronged aggression as he's tucked in between the Evolution Chamber and the Mineral Line. Somehow an SCV's there. The Thors are hitting the Mutalisks. Oh my goodness. Gumiho taking some commanding fights, knocking down that fourth. And with the drop still alive, with all of the Mutalisks destroyed, Gumiho can position himself for another fight and potentially move on to a DreamHack Grand Final, Todd.
It's 137 army supply to 108 here in Gumiho's favor. He's going to move across the map. He's going to set up, you know, to receive that army, which still has a lot of banelings, about 50 here for True. But True is now not just three bases. Yeah. He'd like to be on four. He's trying to retake that fourth base. Gumiho has been so patient, never really stepping on creep.
Yeah,
always staying at the very edge of it, pre-splitting. It's been impossible for True to engage into Gumiho's army, but now finally he's stepping on creep. He's confident enough, and we're going to have the big fight happen, Nathanius.
This is going to be True's desperate push to get him back to keep his DreamHack hopes alive. The Banelings are moving in, the Thors up front to soak up, but so much of this army is off creep. He's starting to pre-split away from the Banelings off creep. The Mutalists are going to run in, soaking up every last shot. The supply dwindling for both players at this time, but the Mutalists should be able to clean up a lot of the medevacs as they try to retreat. Widowmines are going to burrow. Gumiho trying to hold on against the counterattack, but he's still just fighting in the center of the map.
He has a fourth base, though. Gumiho already set up, but no PF, no turrets. If True was to head down there, it could do a little bit of damage. True, finally, with a big fight win, he's been needing this
keeping
entire game.
The medevacs are the key here. You know,
yeah.
Gumiho is a little bit behind in supply. Most of his active supply are actually these medevacs. But
did he make enough barracks to make up for basically not having to make medevacs right now?
I mean, by only having the five barracks, he's relying a lot on spending his resources on Thors and Widowmines,
yeah,
which we've seen be very useful in this composition, but he doesn't have to spend the money on more medevacs. He comes in to fight this again, and this is where that fourth base you mentioned, if he comes
oh
in and hits
God,
it,
very the turrets.
Important. Two turrets to finish up. These are actually tantamount for his defense, actually keep going to stop the Banelings on the Marines.
True's losing everything. He's committed so much to this. The Mutas dying. They are dying. And they are so important. He needs to preserve them. That fourth base not about to go down anytime soon here for Gumiho, and all of a sudden he's going across the map.
Oh,
oh wow.
Well, that's just insult to injury, Todd. You know, by keeping the medevacs alive, he's able to invest all of his resources into remaxing on the fighting.
Look at the army supply.
And this has just been amazing for Gumiho.
87 army supply to 47. True's trying to regroup. He's trying to get some banelings out right now. He's going to do just that. But look at the micro. He's guiding banelings away. There is a medivac in the natural. About to drop some units here, I think. Some Widowmines. Why not?
Dealing with these this late in the game, quite annoying. Drones are going to fall down. It ain't nothing but a thing, Todd, as he's pushing into this third. Once again, with no banelings with this army, Gumiho should not be able to be stopped. Pushing forward, cleaning up the last of the Mutalisks and making his way towards the DreamHack Open Grand Finals here in France. The Mutalisks falling left and right. More Marines coming across the map. Six more Mutas in production, but it will not be enough. GG! Gumiho is going to the Grand Finals here at DreamHack Open Tour.
Is happy in Athenians. I think they wanted him to win.
Yeah,
a lot of people say they wanted to win.
I think all the Terran bros out there are happy for Gumiho moving on. A phenomenal performance by a player that's been haunting the Korean scene for quite some time. He will face parting in the grand finals. And it looks like we're just about ready to hear what the man himself has to say up on the main stage with Smix.
Dua, give it up for your second grand finalist, Gumiho! Gumiho, I see you standing here. You're gazing out at the crowd. What is going through your head right now? This must feel amazing for you to make it to the grand finals.
일단 그 조병재 선수를 보면서 이렇게 팬들을 계속 보고 있잖아요. 진짜 무슨 생각이 드는지 궁금하네요.
제가 지금 긴장이 상당히 많이 되는데 왠지 사람들 많이 봐서 긴장이 많이 되는데 그래도 힘이 더 많이 나는 것 같아요. 그래. 여러분들이 지켜봐 주신 만큼 더 잘할 테니까 많이 지켜봐 주시기 바랍니다.
So Gumio says, looking at you fans, I feel very almost, I just nervous. But at the same time, just as much as I'm nervous, I also feel like I'm getting so much strength from looking at you guys cheering for me. It just feels absolutely amazing. So because you guys are cheering for me so hard, please, please continue to cheer for me. And I'll continue to do well for you guys. Gumio, this looked like such a dominant series from you. But game three was a little bit close. You actually looked at a big disadvantage, but somehow you were able to bring it back and under your control. How are you able to do that?
일단 너무 좀 압도적이게 이겼는데 그 세 번째 경기가 좀 가까웠어요. 좀 불리하게 시작을 했는데 어떻게 하면서 또 역전을 했어요?
딱히 무슨 생각을 하진 않았고요. 일단 막으면서 버티자는 생각이 제일 컸는데 생각보다 3월티가 느리시더라고요. 그래서 중반쯤에는 제가 이길 수 있다는 걸 깨달았어요. 처음에는 그냥 정신이 없었어요.
So Gumio says, at first I wasn't thinking at all. It was a little bit chaotic. I just kind of went with the flow. In the beginning, I just thought if I'm able to hold here, then I'll be able to do well. But then I, as the game kept going onwards, I realized that his third was very late. And so I thought if I can just go from the mid to late game, that I will be able to win. So and I think that's why I was able to come back in that game and make it a 3-0. And last but not least, Gumio, this is your first time in the grand finals of a premier tournament ever. And this is our first time at Tor for DreamHack Open Stop. There's so many firsts here. Can you tell us, do you have any words for the fans? And what does this mean to you to make it to the grand finals for this first time, for the first time?
일단 이렇게 결승전 진출이 처음이잖아요. 그리고 이렇게 드림핵, 우리 드림핵도 여기 프랑스가 처음이고 이 팬들도 진짜 너무 멋지고 되게 좋은데 그만큼 팬들도 또 너무 환호 소리 좋은 것만큼 그리고 결승전 처음 진출한 만큼 그 의미가 뭔지 설명해 주세요.
지금부터 오늘 기점으로 제가 더 발전될 것 같고요. 그리고 여러분도 정말 최고인 것 같습니다. 함성 소리 때문에 항상 더 힘이 나는 것 같아요.
So he says, first of all, starting from today, I feel like I'm going to grow so much as a player. And I also want to say, you guys are just so freaking awesome. I honestly think that I get so much strength from hearing you guys here. So thank you so much. Congratulations again, Gumio, on making it to the grand finals. I'm looking forward to that finals very much. And speaking of which, we are going to have that broadcasted at 10:30 p.m. local time, but the pre-show will start at 10:15 p.m. So don't miss it. Don't go anywhere. Stay tuned then. Until then, we'll be on a break.